one of ours!
Daniels?
We need to get the hell out of here! Get her to the truck! We got this covered!
Yes, sir!
Trying to clean house!
Daniels, get over here!
Hotel's almost ours! We're taking the lobby!
Anna! Thank you. Mama hat gesagt, ich soll mich Kaspar kümmern. Die kommen nicht zurück.
Okay, they can take it from here. Let's go.
We're escorting them and that's final.
Street clear. Everyone okay?
Kann jemand einen Lasterfahren? Wie in einem Breckenhäuschen.
Ja, ich kann fahren.
Come on!
Look out!
They shot up the truck!
She's gone.
Go on!
Go!
What the hell are you doing?
Following orders. Everyone back to the hotel. Move, move, move! Hey, there's nothing we can do.
Buddy, this is DK Dynamite, and today what I have for you guys is a video that I've promised for quite a while. Yes, my general review of Call of Duty World War II. We're gonna get right to the point. It has been close to 3 months since the launch of Sledgehammer Games' current Call of Duty game, and we're gonna be breaking down everything I liked and disliked about the campaign and the multiplayer side of things as well. I have a separate video coming out talking about zombies, the game mode itself, and where it stands today. So right off the bat, I think this campaign really captured the atmosphere of World War II. It's such an iconic war, and it's not iconic because so many people died. That, of course, is a factor, but it's iconic because there's very powerful figures that were around during that time. You know, Winston Churchill, President Roosevelt, and so many other people as well. And like I said earlier, even though they couldn't name drop some of these people, they still capture the atmosphere of World War II through such vivid and graphic campaign missions where you saw death right in front of you and you saw frightened soldiers. And the only reason why it doesn't live up to campaigns like Black Ops or Modern Warfare is only because many of the characters in this game just weren't memorable, like Alex Mason, Woods, Reznov, Captain Price, Soap, Ghost, and even the antagonist. You know, there really wasn't a core antagonist for this game as there have been for previous Call of Duties, but I still think that Sledgehammer is still lacking in that field. They were lacking in that with Advanced Warfare. They're lacking with it in World War II. And hopefully, in an upcoming Call of Duty that they develop, they do create some very iconic characters that are just as memorable as the ones from the Black Ops and Modern Warfare trilogy. But in terms of gameplay with the campaign, there definitely weren't any moments where I felt bored or just rushed. There weren't any moments like that. I think everything was fairly balanced. The gameplay was smooth. The weapons were great. You know, they tried to include as many weapons as they could. Here for the launch of World War II, I think many other weapons that we may love from history itself are probably going to be included in future DLC. I'll tell you that much. The score of the game was very, very nice. I think it's one of the best scores we've heard since Black Ops 3, or even before that as well. And in terms of your squad helpers, this is where a lot of mixed reviews came in for this. So this is the first Call of Duty campaign in a while, I think since COD 3 or COD 2, that you don't really have health regeneration. And you also don't have a limited ammo for many of the missions either. You know, you have to rely on your squad if you needed health, if you needed ammo, if you needed equipment. You had to ask your squad. To me, that was actually one of my favorite parts about this campaign. It was a lot more realistic, not on the same level as the Battlefield franchise, but still, for a Call of Duty, that was fairly realistic for Sledgehammer to do. You know, not just relying on yourself, not just relying on your level of skill, but making sure that if you need some health, ammo, and equipment, you're near the squad members that have it. And if you die at a certain point in the game, you better hope that you spawn back at a checkpoint in which you have a decent amount of ammo and health, because if you don't, you're gonna go through hell trying to figure out what to do next and how to survive. But I will, of course, leave a link down below to the stream where I completed the entire campaign in one sitting. Yes, it was that good to me. It's not perfect, not on the level of the Black Ops or Modern Warfare games, but still a great way to bring Call of Duty back to its roots. That's the simple way that I can put it without boring you guys to death. But once again, another fantastic part about this campaign is the ability to see some of those concentration camps. You know, I was getting a little nervous towards the end of the game that we weren't going to see any. Not that I like to see fucking Jews getting massacred in concentration camps, but that's a very important part of World War II. And seeing the reactions from the soldiers, that right there is super, super important to include in your game. And they finally did it at the end during the epilogue of this game. And in terms of leaving the door open for sequels, I think this was kind of a one-off for Sledgehammer. You know, go to World War II, visit some iconic moments throughout the war, bring us some decent characters, some nice dialogue, and some very good action, and call it a day. And I think in terms of the future for Sledgehammer, Advanced Warfare 2 is certainly a possibility, since they were thinking about it and even working on it before Activision told them, nope, you got to go back to the past. So who knows what they'll do next, but I think a Call of Duty to be solely focused on one specific war is putting a lot of pressure on developers. And, you know, we really haven't seen that before. We, of course, have seen a fictional World War III with MW3. We saw some focus on the Cold War and even Vietnam with the first Black Ops. We've seen a little bit of the Korean War, I would say. You can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think to focus an entire Call of Duty on one war is definitely a lot of work, and I think Sledgehammer really captured as much as they can with the resources they were given and the time that they had as well. But moving on to the multiplayer side of things, this is where I think Sledgehammer lacked the most, and I know people would disagree with that and say, no, zombies where they fucked up, they didn't include enough. But I think when it comes to multiplayer, this is where I expected so much more. The game just lacks content, and with the release of DLC 1, yes, it's nice to be refreshed with a couple of new maps and a new war operation, but other than that, how long can that last? I don't see that lasting. I don't see that hype lasting any more than a couple more weeks. I just don't see it. And the thing is, as I said before, with Black Ops 3, strip away every DLC and just play those core maps that released on disc. And I'm fine with that. I could play those maps over and over again. I can rank up each weapon, have fun getting the camos, using the different score streaks in that game. But with World War II, I don't see the variety. I don't see the exclusivity with this game. I can tolerate multiplayer maps like Aiken, Forest, Flak Tower, London Docks, and Point du Hoc. But other than that, that's about it. The rest of the maps are complete dog shit to me. They play like fucking shit. They fucking operate like fucking shit. The layout is fucking shit. I just can't stand it. And many hardcore Call of Duty fans will also agree with this. When it comes to focusing a Call of Duty solely on World War II, as I said earlier, I could think of dozens of badass multiplayer maps for that. You can even take some inspiration from World at War and some older Call of Duty games. There's so much you can do. To choose that bullshit map Carentan as your season pass bonus is a terrible mistake, and I talked about that in a separate video as well. It's fucking terrible. It has to be the worst season pass bonus I've ever played. It's just garbage. Complete garbage. And when it comes to War, I also talked about that in a separate video as well. I just think War is a perfect step in the right direction when it comes to innovation, but other than that, it's just a huge letdown that we only have three maps to really choose from, one of those maps being a map that was available during the beta, so we're already maxed out on that. We only have two other maps to kind of fuck with, which everybody got burned out on within the first 3 weeks of the game. We have one new one with DLC 1, but once again, that won't last more than another week. Everybody's playing it, everybody's enjoying it, and the aspects of it, and that's about it. Onto the wait for DLC 2. That's how the community is going to be responding to Sledgehammer games in the next couple of weeks, I promise you. But once again, look at a game like Black Ops 3 or a game like Ghost or the Modern Warfare games. We were perfectly fine with the way that game launched. They were all addicting. World War II is addicting to me when I have something to go for, when I'm aiming to win or complete 50 matches to get a new weapon, or when I'm aiming to unlock a certain piece of clothing or something in that area. But other than that, take that away and there's nothing for me to do. If it wasn't for Winter Siege, if it wasn't for the Resistance event, then I wouldn't really have much to do in this game. I do want to make a video coming out soon talking about each specific multiplayer map and the faults of each one, and some of the upsides of most of them as well. I'll kind of be breaking down each multiplayer map, showing gameplay of each one, what went wrong with the development of each map, and so on. Let me know if you want to see that video down below in the comments section. I'll be uploading it very, very soon. But yes, in terms of content, they just lack way too much when it comes to the multiplayer map list. I was expecting at least 11 to 15 multiplayer maps for such a massive Call of Duty like this, focusing on one war that has so many iconic figures, settings, and vehicles. They could have done so much more. That's all I'll say with that. Yes, I talked about war and the entirety of that mode in a different video, so I won't really go back into it again. But in terms of score streaks, yes, I almost said kill streaks because I'm used to having kill streaks in a boots on the ground Call of Duty, not of course including Black Ops 2 and Ghost. But when it comes to the score streaks in this game, I only really use UAV, glide bomb, and probably the fighter pilot at most. That's about it. When it comes to earning the highest streak, which is the turret gunner, I don't really put much use to it. Yes, it's powerful for certain maps, but since the layout of most of the maps is complete shit, it's so easy for people to just hide inside and avoid all that bullshit. It really is. You know, our artillery barrage, flat guns, they're okay. They do a little bit of damage. You know, the flat guns take out the score streaks. The artillery barrage has the capability of taking out the entire team if you get it on time. That's about it. You have carpet bombing, which usually gets somebody kicked when they use it on fucking hardcore. That's about it. Other than that, there's not really a variety. We do have the flamethrower, but okay, the hype for that kind of died during the beta when people used it on war. And we do have cocktails, okay? They're banned on MLG, but they still are pretty fun to use on a game mode like Search and Destroy. And when it comes to the game modes here in World War II, they're pretty much the same as any other Call of Duty. You know, we do have Gridiron, which is a different version of Uplink. Essentially the same thing with a different name. I haven't played much of it, but I do have a goal to upload a live commentary on each game mode here within World War II, and I'm about halfway done with that. Now, with the weapons, I do also have a video that I plan on making. It probably won't be uploaded for quite a while, maybe close to the launch of DLC 2, kind of breaking down each weapon in the game, telling you guys what I like about each one. But what I will say is this, Sledgehammer did the right thing with ensuring variants don't affect the statistics of each weapon. That's definitely something I want to talk about right now, and it's probably the issue that ruined my experience with Advanced Warfare. I think Advanced Warfare had a very interesting year. I think there were some very cool multiplayer maps in that game. The movement was never really a problem to me. It was really just the variants. The fact that I can shoot somebody and not win the gunfight just because he's using a weapon that has different statistics from mine. But it's the same base weapon. It's just a variant of my weapon. It's an epic version. It's a legendary version, which has better damage, less recoil, shit like that. It just pissed me the fuck off. Because I did spend a little bit of money in Advanced Warfare and never really got shit. Spent a little bit of money in Black Ops 3, got a lot of shit, so I spent more. My motivation to spend more is when I get shit. Advanced Warfare, I just didn't. I just really didn't. And the fact that Sledgehammer kind of did a 180 on that whole system and made sure that variants in World War II simply look different, don't feel different, is huge for me. A weapon like the PPSH, which honestly, everybody uses it on competitive, and a lot of people use it during pubs. This is a weapon where if you get a variant, you'll have a different iron sight for it. And that different iron sight actually helps you play a lot better. I feel like I have more accuracy with it. I feel like when I pick it up off the ground, I can definitely be ensured a couple more kills using that versus the core PPSH, which I'm not really a fan of. I just feel like the sight is too dull. It's not that circular one that I really have enjoyed since Black Ops 3 and even World at War and other Call of Duties that had it as well. So when it comes to PPSH is like the Duck Soup or the Thrive. You have a really cool iron sight on there, which helps you play a lot better. But it's not changing the statistics of the gun where you have better damage, better chance of killing somebody, less recoil. It doesn't change anything else. So yes, they're cosmetic only. And that's what I was hoping for when they said they were doing variants in Advanced Warfare, but they didn't do it. You know, Infinite Warfare reintroduced that bullshit system, and that's what instantly turned me off when I heard they were doing that. I'm like, fuck that. I'm not having another year where I have people using the same guns as me, but they have better variants because they spent more money or just had better luck. Black Ops 3 didn't have variants. They had base weapons only. So it was a huge gamble when you're trying to go for one of those new DLC weapons. You know, there aren't variants of any of them. You couldn't do any challenges to unlock them. You had to just gamble with cryptic keys or COD points to get what you want. Modern Warfare Remastered is a Call of Duty that really got me hyped for this new system using salvage and essentially completing challenges to get what you want. So Modern Warfare Remastered would have it where you'll earn salvage by earning duplicates from your supply drops, and you can use that salvage to craft what you want. If you did certain challenges in the game, you'd get more salvage and you'd get more credits to use in the depot of Modern Warfare Remastered. So it was a step in the right direction towards allowing the community to get what they wanted without spending a lot of money. And World War II built even more on top of that to go and say, hey, if you complete or win 30 or let's say 50 multiplayer matches, you'll get this new weapon. Boom. They included that in the order section at the headquarters. That right there is perfect. That's all I ever wanted. If people could complain, oh, that's too many matches, I'm not going to be able to complete all those, that's too much grinding for one gun, suck a fucking dick. That's a great way, a free way to get a gun that just came out. It's free. You don't have to pay for anything. Just play multiplayer. That is fair. No matter if people think it's bullshit because it's too much, in the end, it's free. And of course, you can also use this salvage that you collect from earning duplicates in World War II to then craft a weapon that you want. It's essentially put into a collection of, let's say, 7 to 10 items. And once you get all those items unlocked, either by opening them in drops or unlocking them with your salvage, boom, it'll then grant you with that specific variant or that specific weapon. That, to me, is perfect. So Sledgehammer nailed the variant system this time. I'll give them that. I really will. But when it comes to the variety of weapons, I think they also did a good job with giving us as much as they can. I did say earlier that if there are any weapons from World War II that we know in real life, then you can bet they'll include them as DLC. When it comes to community events in this game, I think that's what actually saved my replayability for this game. I think that's what actually gave me a reason to play. It really gave me a reason to play. They included new weapons in each event. They included new items you can earn from your supply drops, things that look cool. They kind of changed the headquarters a little bit. Winter Siege gave us a Christmas tree, some new weapons. The Resistance got us hyped up for DLC 1, providing us with new weapons to unlock and some cool new uniforms to go along with that French Resistance theme that we've, of course, seen throughout the campaign as well. We also saw some British references with this event. So I do think that these events build replayability for the game, but without them, strip all that away, as I was saying earlier, there just isn't enough. There's not enough multiplayer maps, not enough war maps, and it really bothers me because they could have done more. But I'll stick to my theory that, hey, they had a lot of development going on for Advanced Warfare 2, and when they were forced to scrap that or maybe just put it away on a shelf for a different time, I think that's kind of what screwed over their development on multiplayer. They kind of put together what they could in the shortest amount of time possible. And, you know, we don't have a multiplayer map for D-Day, but we do have an Operation of War that takes place during D-Day. So that was kind of how they accommodated for some of those big events. But they didn't take too many areas from the campaign and put them into multiplayer maps. They tried doing something differently with multiplayer, and it didn't work out too well because, like I said, there aren't enough maps. And I don't know if because the resources went to war is why they didn't do that many multiplayer maps, but, you know, stripping away one map from every DLC, and what I mean by that is only releasing 3 new multiplayer maps and then 1 new war operation, that of course doesn't help the issue. You know, I understand the resources go to war, but come on, this is multiplayer. The main part of your Call of Duty that'll keep it alive, aside from zombies. Now, when it comes to the division system of World War II multiplayer, this is where I think there's a feature that Sledgehammer really came up with that sounds phenomenal on paper, but just doesn't play well. You know, you're thinking about this, all right? You have a division, right? Set to airborne, and you have this basic training set to hustle where you could essentially reload faster while sprinting. You then can't assign an ability to equip another primary attachment. You know, you're restricting players more than you're allowing them to customize. You're drawing too far away from this usual pick 10 or pick 13 system where you can also equip as many perks as you can to fill up those slots. And now you're essentially restricting players as to what abilities they can have. You can only choose one at a time. And then you can have one division, which could, of course, grant you with a bayonet on your assault rifle or the ability to stay hidden from UAVs or an ability to have a knife next to your pistol. You know, things like that. What if you want to mix and match? You just can't. You can't mix and match shit in this game. And some people think, oh, well, you don't need it. You know, you're creating more noobs when you give them that freedom. But what has Call of Duty been based on for so many years? You know, this is a great way to innovate Call of Duty, but there's just not enough customization with this. There's not enough freedom, I should say, with this to where you can say, okay, well, let's mix and match some of these basic trainings, you know. Let's give them the ability to use a wild card, which is where you can mix and match 2 to 3 basic trainings, or having the ability to use a merge of 2 different divisions. You know, maybe you could play as an undercover soldier who acts like he's an airborne but really is a resistance fighter. You know, something like that. You know, some type of idea where you can mix some of these abilities together to make a truly unique class. And I do think Treyarch will return to their usual pick 10 or pick 13 system in their next Call of Duty, but if they don't, and this is the new trend for Call of Duty multiplayer, then I'm not really a fan of it. Because like I said, when it comes to even competitive Call of Duty, playing MLG, playing game battles, you will notice that there's probably some competitive players who are like, fuck, I need this, but I also need that, and I can't use both, so you know what, I'm gonna have to deal with just one, hopefully not die because I didn't have the other thing. Shit like that is what really ruins the experience for me here in multiplayer, but I've dealt with it, and I think I'll be able to deal with it until the end of World War II's life cycle. But September tried it this time, they might try it next time, but hopefully if it's not the time after that, they'll at least give us the ability to merge some of these abilities to make something truly special and not just be limited to one ability per basic training or a couple of different attachments or concepts you can use with each division. It's a cool idea, I'll give you that, but something that really pissed me the fuck off is the Incendiary division. This is just fucking bullshit. It's honestly a division that caters to noobs. You know, you talk about how you're creating more noobs if you let people merge different basic trainings, but come on, the Incendiary division is catering to people who not only enjoy shotguns, but enjoy what I would call free kills. You know, you're giving them incendiary shells on their shotguns, which essentially means if you get shot with just one bullet, just one, you're most likely going to die if you're even fairly close to that person. Or let's say you're coming off of a gunfight and you're one shot, that thing is going to kill you. Yes, the shotgun would have already killed you anyway, but to add fire onto that, there's not even a chance to turn around and fucking turn someone on with your fucking rifle or SMG. Come on now, that is fucking bullshit. Probably one of the worst things they could have came up with. But you know what? I'd rather take the Incendiary division over variants and bullshit that we saw with Advanced Warfare. Now, when it comes to the time to kill here in World War II multiplayer, this is the killer for my multiplayer experience. I'll give you this. Sledgehammer has been improving it over time, and maybe in the next couple weeks, you'll see a truly polished time to kill in this game. But never, not once, have I felt like in Call of Duty multiplayer, I'm almost always one shot, no matter what gunfight I'm getting. And I just feel like every time I win a gunfight, I'm one shot. You know, if I get shot one time and I run away, I'm one shot. Never once have I felt this way in a Call of Duty game. It is fucking ridiculous. And I'll try to show some examples on screen, but I just don't feel like this is in any way balanced compared to boots on the ground Call of Duty we saw in Ghost, the Black Ops games, or even Modern Warfare. Never once have I felt this. Even when I started playing COD, when I first played Call of Duty 4 online, never once did I feel like some of these gunfights are unfair. Never once did I feel like I'm always one shot every corner I fucking turn. And the way that some of these multiplayer maps are so dull just means that if you avoid getting shot at, maybe you get shot once or twice and you run away, maybe you win a gunfight and try to escape that area so you can regenerate some health. The way these maps are so dull, it's just almost impossible to do that. And yes, there are some great maps, as I said earlier, like Aiken and Flak Tower, where I feel like I can truly control the map and get some great kills on. But when it comes to bullshit-ass maps like Gabrilatar, I think you say it, and Gustav Cannon, these are maps that are like, what the fuck? How do I even survive? You know, there's just so many snipers, so much bullshit. The maps play so slow. How can I even get somewhere safe where I can regenerate health? You just can't. And another map like USS Texas, there's just too many ways for you to get fucked. And I know that sounds funny, but like I said, not ever in another Call of Duty game have I felt like there's a bad mix of time to kill, multiplayer map selection, and this customization system. And I just think that this really killed my mood. And if it wasn't for the community events, as I said, like Winter Siege and the Resistance, and with the introduction of new weapons, then I wouldn't have motivation to play this game. I can just go play Ghost if I want to play a truly polished Call of Duty. And, you know, I've also said, last-gen CODs have launched with more content. A lot of YouTubers will argue this. You have CODs that launch with so many more game modes, so many more multiplayer maps, you know, a truly in-depth campaign, party games in multiplayer, things like that. Why not include them at launch of such a big Call of Duty like this, which actually it was supposed to benefit from an additional year of development, but did it really? Did Sledgehammer waste a couple of months developing Advanced Warfare 2 before Activision was like, fuck you, it's not gonna happen? Some people will say, oh, well, you know, there's no way they got that far in development, Activision would have saw right away, but you know, who really knows? Who really knows? When Advanced Warfare came out, it kind of got a mixed reception. When Black Ops 3 came out, it was highly praised. Yes, some people hated it. Some people thought that it was bullshit, worse than Advance. That is fine. But overall, Black Ops 3 was super successful. So I do think Activision was like, you know, let's wait before we abandon this Advance movement. Let's see what Infinity Ward does. And I think, as I said before, I think Infinity Ward has something a lot different planned for Infinite Warfare multiplayer, but since it didn't look like it would have been as successful, and due to the fact that the campaign trailer got so much shit on it, Activision wanted to have Infinity Ward mimic the success of Black Ops 3 as much as possible by essentially copy and pasting Black Ops 3's movement system and the core mechanics of the Create a Class system as well. So, looking at what Sledgehammer Games did this year, I do think they have a lot to work on when it comes to polishing multiplayer. At least they're not missing core features of the game, like leaderboards and emblem editor, shit like that. At least that's in the game compared to fucking Infinite. But when it comes to time to kill, this is something that has to be fixed. And I hope to never play a Call of Duty ever again that has a time to kill like this one. Because at least if you have good multiplayer maps in the game, you know, you'll know the map, you control the map a little bit better. You'll know where you can go to regenerate health. But this game, god damn, the time to kill fucking blows. And a lot of people did say, oh, well, it's similar to Black Ops 2 and Ghost. And nope, it's not. I never once felt like I was one shot every fucking minute of the game when I'm playing multiplayer. But leave all your feedback down below in the comment section. It is okay if you disagree with any of the points I made in this video. Everybody is, of course, entitled to their own opinion. But think about this. I did wait quite a while to make this video. I played a lot of World War II. I put a lot of time into the campaign, a lot of time into multiplayer. So do not say that I'm inexperienced with the game to be making some of these arguments here in the video. So stay tuned in for more World War II content coming up in the next couple of days. I'll be posting a few more videos for the first DLC. I will then be exploring some other titles while we wait for DLC 2 here in this game. As I said, unless there is a huge community event, the introduction of new weapons, or something really cool that brings me into World War II and build replayability, then I do plan on covering some other games here on my channel, doing some more fun streams on games like Resident Evil, as people really enjoyed when I did that on my VR. I'll probably be exploring games like Doom VR and some other cool ones just released as well. But this has been DK Dynamite. Let me know what you think down below, and thanks so much for watching. Peace out, everybody.
I'm guessing they made an example out of them.
They'd slaughtered the weakest, anyone that was slowing them down.
Daniels, over here. Daniels, you gotta see this. The tracks lead to the fields. That's where they must have marched them.
Then that's where we're going.
I wouldn't get your hopes up, Corporal.
I made a promise to Sussman.
We'll find him. I just can't guarantee we'll find him alive. Red, take the shot!
Take the shot! Take the shot!
Shaken with the violences of war. in this hour of great sacrifice. We shall prevail.
Thank you.